Great. So I'm going to do a quick introduction of our panelists. I encourage you to look at their full bios online in the program because they are all amazing folks. So first up, we have Joshua Berger, who's a chief sport officer at Esports Reputation, a company that manages 50 of the best FIFA esports players and teams. We also have today Jake Lyon, player in the Overwatch League with the Houston Outlaws. Noah Whinston, who is co-founder and CEO of Immortals, a global esports org whose players participate in a number of games. Nigel Houston, a world champion skateboarder who hopes to compete in Tokyo 2020, actually at skateboarding's inaugural appearance in the games. Sarah Walker, a pro BMX athlete, Olympic medal winner, and member of the IOC's Athletes Commission. And then we have a chair at the end. We have another panelist who may still join us, Mariano Caraval-Matus, who's a dance sport athlete and is actually competing here this week. So if somebody comes running in, that's who it is. All right, so I want to start actually with a little bit of an old school style poll. Can you raise your hand if you play some kind of sport? Casually, professionally, seriously. All right. Can you raise your hand if you play some kind of computer game? Mobile game. Okay. we could probably do a version where you keep your hands up, but I suspect many of you will fit both of those categories, and I think that's the case for many of our panelists here as well. So today we want to continue this conversation about esports in the IOC context, in the Olympics context, and I think one of the most useful ways to start that is to give folks, especially those who aren't familiar with esports, some sense of what it's like actually to be a high-level competitor. So I want to maybe direct this to Jake to kick us off. Talk a little bit about what it means to be a high-level competitor in esports. What does the work of playing esports look like?
So I think at the most fundamental level, it's in the most public level, it's really just about the competition, right? When we play our professional matches, there's quite a bit of money and realistically the future of our careers on the line. If we don't win, if we consistently don't win, those careers will be short. And that is just the reality of the industry. It's incredibly competitive. So I would say the way I conceive of my work as an esports competitor is just win, as Noah put it to me earlier today, which I think is an effective catalyst for understanding. It is gaming, right, which is a trend that I think a lot of people understand and have seen, whether themselves or their kids or someone they know is playing games. It's hard to find somebody who can't relate to that, at least. But esports is the extreme variety, right? Putting that to the absolute test, not just playing the games for fun, for enjoyment, the way most of the player base does consume this kind of media, but actually trying to be the best and trying to become the optimal player at whatever games that we play. So of course, it looks very different. Your practice, your matches, all these things look very different across various different games, different titles within the esports space. But as an individual player, I think the common theme is that intense level of competition and that high level of practice you put in to really be the best that you can be.
Great, thanks. So one of the things that often comes up when discussing esports in a sports context is this issue of physicality. And so many people think of physicality as an anchor for athleticism. And I'd love for us to just wrangle with that idea a little bit. Is there physicality in esports? Is the kind of physicality we imagine with BMX or skateboarding distinctly different than what we're seeing in esports?
Yeah, so I'd say that BMX and skateboarding probably have the edge on us when it comes to physicality. But at the same time, there is a physicality element to esports. As a professional esports organization, when we're taking care of our players and we're trying to just win, as Jake said, that's not just about putting our players in front of a computer and having them practice the game itself. We have a physical trainer, a nutritionist, a physical therapist to both prevent and heal repetitive stress injuries, a sports psychologist to make sure that mindset is correct and that team synergy is correct before going into the game. So there's certainly elements of both kind of physical and mental wellness that carry over from the more traditional sports and competitive world into the esports and competitive world. But I think trying to draw a very definitive boundary of this is how much physicality you need before it's a sport, I think is maybe a little bit too much of a subjective judgment. From my perspective, esports is a sport or a competition, whatever terminology you want to use, because it's competitive and it has a lot of people watching it that are invested in the outcome. And whether you're using your finger muscle or your leg muscle or your core muscles to compete, it's still competition.
And I would like to add to that as well. I think it's really hard to compare even current Olympic disciplines to each other. Like, I definitely wouldn't be able to run a marathon.
Great point.
But does that make me unfit? Well, I compete at the top level of my sport, and I put a lot of hours into training every week. So it is really hard to kind of compare esports as a whole to the Olympic movement as a whole. But I think something that I keep coming back to is at the Olympic level, if I want someone to try my sport, they have to go out and ride a bike around the BMX track. Where I feel like in gaming, if you want to go out and try the sport, you sit on the couch, and I think that's mm-hmm. the big difference. I've been in the gym when gamers have come in to do gym work. So, and the fact that us as athletes, we find those 1%ers, we go to nutrition, psychology. There's so many similarities at that top level, but I come back to the influence we have on the young kids that watch us, and that's where I struggle a little.
I mean, I feel like a lot of it's just mental, too. I mean, I'm assuming seeing you where you're at, you're pretty good under pressure, and I mean, it's the same thing. I feel like there's so many skateboarders out there and anyone in their sport that can be so good at it, but might not have what it takes to make it happen when it really means it, and I'm assuming you're good under pressure. I've been pretty good under pressure. So, yeah, it has a lot to do with it, too.
Absolutely. I mean, at some kind of level, when you really try to get world success, for example, in Jake's case, playing on such a high level, you do everything that could strengthen yourself before the tournament start, like keeping the 5 or 10%, making your concentration level better. And what everybody has to understand is that the esports athletes really have to focus, have to concentrate for many, many hours during everyday practice, of course, but in the tournaments, they have a group stage, they have the KO system, etc., and these games are really long. Like sometimes you are having a tournament day with 4, 5, 6 hours of playing, and it's just natural that after the first 3 hours, your concentration level would become worse. And what can you do against that is just go doing fitness and keep your mental strength nice.
I think if you want to compare the physicality in esports, as Noah said, I mean, obviously it's not the same, and even at the top level, it's not mandatory. It's really about pushing the boundaries. And I think what's driven the physicality in esports to where now we have personal trainers and nutritionists, this is relatively common at the top level, is that we're pushing for those little tiny edges, right? At some point you practice so much that maybe practicing another hour of the game is not going to make you as much more effective in a tournament setting as being, you know, more physically fit or more prepared, as you said, to concentrate for longer. So it's like these little edges become more important than the practice of the fundamental thing itself, which I'm sure you can relate to in other sports and other disciplines, which is it's not all about just exactly practicing the maximum number of hours. There's other things, like you go to the gym, you know, there's other things that can aid in your performance that aren't just practicing the sport itself. But for us, that's all of our physicality, is in those other little things, is in those last 5-10%. So the ratio is flipped, I think, for esports, where most of it is that work of concentration, that performance under pressure. And then the last bit is the athleticism. But if I look at some other Olympic disciplines, one I've come back to a few times is the precision shooting sports, and I kind of see in some ways similarities in the sense that it's about having like extreme precision. I mean, I'm by all means not an expert, but from watching as a casual observer, it does seem like it's all about precision, focus, intensity, performance under pressure. All these things come into play, and from my perspective, it doesn't seem all that different than being really precise with a keyboard and mouse.
Great, thanks. It's interesting because Sarah was teasing me beforehand because I had sent an email to the panelist and I had used BMX. I had sort of called BMX and skateboarding traditional sports. And of course, actually, they're really new sports in the Olympic movement context. And so I want to I want us to talk a little bit about this issue of new sports, because eSports is just the latest of a domain that's kind of entering into conversation with the Olympics. So as we know, you know, a lot of these sports come from enthusiasts, grassroots communities that have faced all kinds of challenges, sometimes stigma, around those emerging domains. And we also know often that sometimes those new emerging sports will resist being pulled into big formal organizations like the Olympics and the Olympics movement. And I wonder if we can talk a little bit from, in your respective domains, what your sense is of how your own space has gone through that and costs, benefits, and sometimes even the resistances to being a part of this Olympic movement in some way.
Yeah, it's crazy. I mean, I feel like so many kids skateboard around the world that I'm surprised it took this long for it to get in the Olympics. But I'm so stoked that it's going to be there for the first time. I'm going to do my best to be there, and I'm really excited. But yeah, it's interesting. There's always going to be, in sports like skateboarding, there's always going to be those people that want it to stay in that core little bubble and not go outside of it and be more mainstream and be an actual sport. But I actually posted a photo last night on Instagram asking my fans like what they thought about skateboarding being in the Olympics, and most people were actually really positive about it, and they were like, oh, I don't see why it wasn't already in there. I think it definitely deserves to be in there. So I think it's good to hear a lot of people excited about it, and I feel like if it was 5 years ago, 10 years ago, it would actually be completely different. But what I say back to the people who hate on it, I'm just like, dude, it's gonna get to that point at some time anyways, so I mean, it might as well be now.
Why 5 or 10 years ago would it have been different?
Because skateboarding, and especially contest skateboarding, was so much, I'm not going to say smaller, but just it was so much less mainstream back in the day. And same thing as far as sponsors goes, and yeah, just everything like that.
Thanks. Someone else want to jump in?
Well, being part of BMX, so I was at the first Olympics for BMX in 2008, and the journey I've seen our sport take from that to now, it's life-changing. I definitely wouldn't be sitting here, and I'm not sure what I would be doing with my life at the moment, because this has been such an incredible journey to be involved with the Olympic movement, and it is such a cool experience to go and spend time with teammates from different sports and disciplines from my own country, and then meet people from all over the world from all different sports, and to be sitting here with skateboarding and esports is like, it's really cool to meet so many cool new people and their different experiences and their different stories. It's such a cool world to be a part of.
Absolutely. I mean, I came into esports as a player in 2000, tried to find my way in this back then new business. What it was difficult to call it a business already. It was just something, a community that was like growing consistently. It wasn't a hype or anything. It was far from mainstream. It was very small back then. But over the years, it grew so much. And we fought as an esports community. We fought so much about the attention of the, as I would say, classic sports world, the politics, etc. We really wished the attention of it. And now, nearly 20 years later, of course, sitting here and the Olympic talking about the whole esports topic feels now like final. Yeah, esports is now finally mainstream and in the real classic sports world. But there's a lot of challenges right now, because in the esports guys, esports community, they were like always felt a little bit misunderstood by the, I would say, classic world. So I often speak about two worlds: virtual world, esports world, and classic world, because these are two worlds. It's very important that really don't understand each other yet. And this is why it's so important that there is a permanent discussion, permanent getting to know each other of the two worlds. Because this is really something I feel also when it comes down to the youth and social media, etc. They live on Twitter, they live on Instagram, YouTube, etc., and really consume some other parts of sports in the end.
No, yeah, please.
I guess what I would just say from my side is, you know, it's a little bit of a difficult comparison, right? Because when we're talking about esports being in the Olympics, we're not talking about a single unified sport. We're talking about a family of competitions, right? And so I think when we're thinking about esports, maybe compare it to talking about like snow sports, right? Like esports is snowboarding and skiing and every other snow sport combined into one because there are so many different games, right? And so when we're thinking about participation of esports in the Olympics, right? Number one, like, are there ways to make that participation accretive to the ecosystem rather than disruptive, right? Is there a way to make sure that that adds value to the experience of players and fans and publishers rather than trying to supplant things that already exist? But even more so than that, how it and I imagine one of the major difficulties would be, how do you somehow try to capture this entire esports space with a probably limited number of competitions that you can accommodate within the Olympic, you know, the Olympic tent? Like, what does it mean if Overwatch is in the Olympics but Counter-Strike isn't? Or if FIFA is in the Olympics but, you know, PES, a different soccer esports video game, is not? And so I think that it's very difficult to talk about esports within the Olympics because esports is so broad, but there are also fundamental elements that bind all these different esports together in terms of physicality, demographics of audience, etc. So, you know, it's leaving it a little bit open-ended, of course, because it's tough to come up with a concrete answer around it, but ultimately, the esports audience and the esports fan base supports things that are supportive of them and that add value to their experience. So in a world in which participation in the Olympics creates a better fan experience for esports fans, nobody's going to be against that. But in a world in which participation in the Olympics is disruptive or, you know, supplants value that they care about getting in other places, that's where it can be a little touchier. And I imagine that from a skateboarding perspective, a BMX perspective, right, it's important that the Olympics adds value to the communities where those athletes are coming from and those fans are coming from in order to be accepted by them.
Yeah, please check.
Yeah, and I think to further Noah's point, there's also the question of legitimacy, right? Of like legitimizing what we're doing in esports and making it authentic and real, I guess, to the wider world, the mainstream, as a sport, as a competition. But I think that also poses an interesting challenge or a paradox, maybe, because I feel that esports has kind of created its own validation and has, through simple monetary success, established itself, right? I think my parents thought I was ruining my life. That's why I didn't even tell them I was trying to be a professional gamer until I actually got signed and was cashing paychecks. And then I was like, hey, Mom, I'm making money. And she's like, well, all right, like, I guess I was wrong, you know? Like, but that was the only language that I think she would have ever understood, is that this isn't a waste of my life, that I actually, there is a career here, right? Because I think for most people, they have the perspective, there's no future. You'll never be able to like feed yourself or support a family with this. You know, it's very simple, practical concerns. It doesn't make my parents bad people for not supporting me early on. It's just practical reality. But at the same time, esports has, I think, really achieved that and is continuing to grow in that regard within the ecosystem. And the challenge that Noah mentioned, I think, is really significant, because not only do you need to decide, or does the Olympics need to decide, what within the tent of esports, because you certainly can't include everything, right? There's quite literally millions of titles, right, across, and how long should they stay in the Olympics? There's titles that aren't popular any longer. But even in those titles, there is competition, and it is pervasive throughout the realm of gaming, even when there's no, you know, spotlight and camera on it. I think if you look at almost any title, you'll find some sort of competition if you dig hard enough. But I think on top of that, right, like once you decide, okay, well, we're just going to, let's go with these four games, these five games, then you need to get publisher buy-in, right? Because nobody owns BMX, nobody owns skateboarding. No, you don't have to ask anybody's permission. You have to maybe get buy-in from the community, but you don't need like the quite literal legal permission under the Digital Millennium Copyright Act to display what's going on. And you do for esports. Those publishers must agree. And I think for many publishers, this won't be a problem. There's many publishers who would be more than supportive. But some were very restrictive, and they have extremely high standards when it comes to displaying their game in a televised format. If they're worried that your display of the game might have some bugs, you might have some failures of production, that will reflect negatively on their consumer product, and they will risk losing sales, right? And it's not something they can do as a publicly traded corporation. So I think that those challenges, the logistical challenges behind the issue of deciding what esports to include, are not insignificant.
I would just add on really briefly to what Jake's talking about with validation, right? And say that I think in esports we feel somewhat fortunate that we have like generational inevitability on our side, right? Every year, more people are born, and those people will grow up playing video games, whether that's on a PC or a console or a phone, the same way people 100 years ago grew up playing basketball or soccer or football in the backyard, and some still do. but I think over time, we're ending up in a world where the world is increasingly more digital, barriers to entry are lowering every year with lowering costs of technology, and you end up in a situation where, you know, whether or not esports is in the Olympics, whether or not it's deemed a valid sport by either the Olympics or other international sports bodies of the world, you're going to end up in a world where there's an entire generation under the age of 30 that's growing up with this as their primary form of entertainment and their primary form of participatory competition. And so at the end of the day, like, whether you call it a sport or not, whether you have it next to traditional sports or not on the same podiums, you're going to live in a world where billions of people are already playing it and billions more are going to be participating in it going forward into the future.
That maybe actually gives me a good segue into the next topic I wanted us to tackle. So I spend most of my time outside of the Olympics movement and framework. But one thing I have found really compelling by getting to hear how that space talks about things is the language of athlete rights and responsibilities. We know, for example, right now in esports, you know, there's a lot of hype. There's also a lot of money, or imagine money flowing in. But I wonder if there's a conversation to be had about taking some of that, those frameworks around rights and responsibilities to thinking about what does it look like to protect players in an esports space? How might we think about the continued harassment that happens in gaming that targets, you know, women, people of color, LGBTQ folks? If we really start thinking about the protection and, you know, rights and responsibilities that come with athleticism, how can we fruitfully pull that over to esports in productive ways? And I know, Sarah, you're on the Athletes Commission, so maybe you want to set up that conversation a little bit for us.
Yeah, well, athlete rights and responsibilities is something that we've been working on since November last year, developing a document that can protect and support the athletes of the sporting world, the traditional, I guess. but it's super important. It's such people all around the world, they need that protection. It's such a topical thing at the moment, having that well-being. It's not just sport, it's business, it's all elements of life. And so being able to put something together to be able to create black and white words to say, hey, as an athlete, these things that you should be expected to have. And so dealing with discrimination, like what you're talking about, and then more athlete-specific stuff like selection. How do you make a team? How do you make become an Olympian? All those things are super important to athletes, and being able to talk with them and ask them questions on what's important to them and then create this document has been an amazing process and really eye-opening. And I think it's super important to have that protection and the support for the athletes, because there's been so many situations that I've heard of that no person, regardless of whether they're an athlete or not, that no person should go through that. So it's really important, and I'd love to see that across all areas of sport and definitely in gaming. I think for people out here, I game myself. I do it in my spare time, and it's quite interesting with the discrimination thing. Like, in the game I play, I've never heard a female on the mics talking in game, because it's just something that doesn't happen. I hear 7-year-old kids, boys on the mics, but not girls. And so I think there's already like a little bit of discrimination happening in the background in gaming already.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think often in esports, the framework is, you know, players are just so grateful to actually get a contract, get a shot, you know, do something they love. But yeah, what does it look like to have this conversation about the responsibilities, whether it's leagues or teams, for esports? What are the challenges?
I think my perspective as a player is, as you're saying, I'm still getting used to the right to actually get paid on time. That's a pretty good one to start off with. In terms of, I mean, there's been plenty of tournaments. I had a tournament that we got first place in a couple years ago, and in October, actually October of last year. It's funny how fast things move. But the year before that, so 2 years ago in October, we won a tournament, and I believe we received the winnings a couple months ago. Which was quite funny. I just assumed that they had defrauded us and refused to pay, and I just wasn't worth my trouble anymore. You know, it's not something I can really fight. But of course, so long ago, so I wasn't, you know, at that point I didn't have representation or a salary or anything like that. But even then, there's so many stories of organizations. Ones very much unlike Noah's, I will say, that have consistently not paid players, failed to pay players, or extremely late, delayed payments. So the issue of player rights, I think, for a player in the Overwatch League, I'm in basically, I imagine, one of the best positions possible in esports as a player, in that Blizzard has basically enforced a very standardized contract that has pretty significant protections in terms of what organizations are required to provide at just the boilerplate level of the contract, including minimum salary, including insurance, health insurance. They take care of rent, living situations. So we're getting now, as I think the key element is franchise leagues, right? As soon as you have a franchise league where the teams are private corporations buying into a league that is pre-structured by a developer or some other governing body, now you have the framework to establish rights, which in most games, frankly, just doesn't exist, because it's essentially the organizations are just paying you to put their name and image on your jersey when you play, when you show up to compete. And that was sort of the framework for so long. And I think franchise leagues are the beginning of the conversation of how can we actually make established contracts that are not just about we'll pay you this much for this many months, but include what are your responsibilities, what are the requirements of you, and what are we going to compensate you for those requirements.
I think Joshua's going to... Sorry.
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, many things changed in the last, I would say, 2 to 3 years, but if you see the whole last 15 years, the players really had a hard stand because, again, it's a sport raised by companies in some ways, with a classic politic and sports world, not really knowing this or couldn't help. The players were really the ones who didn't have any consultancy, because in esports you can't go to your parents and ask, hey, how am I dealing with this situation? Because it's easier in classic sports, because parents have like a view, this a contract should look like this or whatever. And in esports, being just a topic, you shouldn't do this, etc. When you go to school and become professional, it's very hard. And what happened really was that the teams, took the players and paying with their name, etc. And the players tried to make a living out of it, because otherwise you couldn't compete on a high level. You would have to practice 8-9 hours every day. To have the chance to become a world champion, and what else could you do if you don't get paid well, etc. The salary situation is awful. Teams taking the personal rights of the players, all the media rights, all the sponsoring rights, and you wouldn't earn anything. Just a few hundred euro, to be honest, in the last in many game titles. And yeah, I saw hundreds of players who tried to make a living but couldn't do it, even if they were major title winners, world champions. I see that it gets professional, and this is something that really touches us also to change that. With 200 football clubs joining in to the topic in the last 2 years, hiring players, it's really a case that has to be professional, and players, of course, have to be protected, but also the teams for themselves, because you have to know the players, they come from their childhood rooms to a complete, to a situation where they have to behave professional completely when they are playing for a major soccer club, for example, or a professional esports team. So both sides really need to care now more for the players to have a professional structure.
Yeah, I want to go to the responsibilities as well. Like, I think we get put into a position where we become role models. It's not something we set out to do. It's not like you wake up every morning, I want to be a role model. You want to be the best that you can be, and that's kind of a natural outcome. And I think something that the Olympic movement does really well is the education to the youth and the next generation about the Olympic values, about the respect, the excellence, the friendship. Like, those are really important messages for the youth of tomorrow. So being able to go to a school, and regardless of whether they're someone that does sport, if they're a musician, if they're into gaming, being able to share those values of respecting others and giving your best and making friends along the way, that messaging is so important, and we have a responsibility as athletes to be able to pass on that messaging. And I think that's where, in my experience at the hobby level of gaming, you don't see that messaging coming through at that same level. So I think that's another element. I think it would be cool to see the esports industry, whether they're part of the Olympic movement or not, is really increase that awareness of sharing those values and teaching the kids that aren't interested in sport that they're how to be a good person, basically. Yeah,
that's a great point.
Yeah, and I think, like he said, it's one of the coolest things about the Olympics, no matter if it's skateboarding or gaming or anything like that, it's just giving kids out there more of an opportunity to actually make a living off of doing what they love. Because, I mean, skateboarding, it's always been so tough for kids out there, and even some of the top people that, like, I'm friends with to skate and do good in contests, there's still, like, not that much money in skateboarding, and it's always been something that, like, mainly back in the day, people looked at it, like, my dad skated, and his parents were never really supportive on it because they didn't really see it being as something that, like, an actual job that you can make money and make a living out of. And I think it's cool that things like the Olympics have helped it get to that level where people actually see it as something where it is cool and you can make a living off of doing what you love, which is the best thing ever.
Noah, given that you own a team, teams, multiple, what's your take on this issue of player rights? And, you know, there's conversation in the esports scene about player associations, for example. So I'd love to hear your perspective.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think, you know, if anything, esports is in an interesting place right now because in some ways the barrier to entry is very low, right? Anybody with a computer can download Overwatch and start playing Overwatch, and there's a public ranked leaderboard, and if you are the best player in the world, you're going to show up visible as the best player in the world to everybody that plays the game of Overwatch, and you'll probably get recruited pretty quickly to a team. On the other hand, that means that, you know, over the years we've ended up recruiting a bunch of, you know, players as young as 16, 17, 18 that have spent the last 5 years playing a game on their PC every single night, which doesn't necessarily prepare you for real life, right? In some ways, they're kind of over-optimized as in-game competitors. And especially when you don't have a kind of youth league, travel league, high school, collegiate program like you would in a traditional sport like basketball, you end up with players that are very talented inside the game that don't necessarily have outside the game skills, whether those are related to competition, like communication, teamwork, mentality, or even outside the context of competition, and this is where you start looking into, like, you know, topics and issues that both traditional sports and digital esports deal with, like harassment, being a good role model, use of social media, etc. So, you know, we as an organization often have to take on the responsibility of educating our players about not just how to be a better athlete from a competitive perspective, but how to be a better athlete from a well-rounded public profile perspective. So yesterday, our players on Los Angeles Valiant, our Overwatch League team, went through active ally training with the You Can Play Project and GLAAD to learn how to be better allies to the LGBTQ plus community. You know, we have robust media training to make sure that our players know how to not say dumb things in interviews, and yet they, of course, still say dumb things in interviews all the time. And, you know, this isn't just an esports problem. In traditional sports, plenty of athletes manage to not learn the necessary codes of conduct to conduct themselves like professionals. But I think esports, because it's such a young industry and because until recently it's been such an unstructured industry, faces those difficulties in a different way, especially in specific titles where the structure is not as strong, right? Like Jake mentioned, Overwatch League being very centralized, being very structured, has helped Overwatch League athletes. But you know, a lot of the issues are much more pervasive in smaller communities that are less developed, both in terms of athlete conduct, but also in terms of financial sustainability, financial sustainability from a getting paid on time perspective. And because esports is such a broad tent, the issues that each title and each player faces are pretty diverse.
Thanks. Oh yeah, Jake.
I want to touch on just a little bit the last part of that question that you mentioned, which is harassment in gaming. And I do think it's a really important critical issue, because I think one of the most compelling things about gaming for me is a sort of deep meritocracy. Like as Noah said, theoretically anybody can download the game, and believe me, if you reach the very top of the leaderboards, you will be noticed, and there will be teams that are interested in paying you money to compete on their behalf. If you are, you know, it doesn't exactly tell you how good a player will be in a competitive environment, but being the number one rated player in the world is a statement for sure. And anybody who can do that, it's a mathematical formula, right? No one is controlling those ratings. No one is deciding who's at the top, only wins and losses. And I think that there is something beautiful about that, right? That it is the ultimate accessibility. And as Noah was saying, as barriers to entry slowly decline, which is going to take a long time for that to, you know, fully happen. But as the world becomes more digital, as barriers decline, it's sort of the one, or one of a very small number, I think, of competitions where I think the long-term future should not have any sort of gendered separated professional leagues. Like, there's no reason that women can't compete with men at the same, like, top level. But of course, if you look at the current reality, it's, I mean, 1% would probably be an overestimation in terms of women competing at the very highest level in various esports titles. And I think the reasons for that are complex and probably too difficult to explain here, and probably beyond my understanding. But I do think that there is hope in that fundamental sense that if we can get more female role models playing at the top level, I think the response to them in the community has been really positive. I know for the one woman that competes in professional level in the Overwatch League, I know a lot of young girls playing the game that look up to her and see her as, wow, like, I can do it too. There's no reason I can't be a pro. Just like she is, that my gender doesn't bar me from competing at the very highest level. And I think that if that can be maximized, right, if that can be focused on, and this is from team side, from developmental side as well, of course, you still have to look for, like, the best player. You really can't make sacrifices on that front for anything else, right? Like, there's plenty of players that are not picked for their interview performance, shall we say. But that is esports. But I think one of the cool things is that if we can get over this hurdle of harassment and we can change the culture, which I think as new titles, new marketing does have, like, impacts on that, and as new gamers come into the space, it slowly shifts. But if we can successfully shift that, I think there's a tremendous amount of reward to be reaped in terms of having a community that's totally unseparated by age, gender, et cetera.
Yeah, I agree. And I think for me, certainly, as, again, somebody who's new to this Olympics movement conversation, seeing the hard work that the Olympics movement does on issues of diversity is absolutely, I think, something we could take back to esports. We need it. And there's a lot of really tremendous potential there. So I think we're about out of time, but I want to thank our panelists so much for a fantastic conversation. And thank you all for coming. We're going to switch out now to the second half, which is on urbanization. So I'll invite Dr. Thorpe up and her panelists.